friends, welcome to the next lesson. This is on administration during British period. The present Indian administrative structure is largely a legacy of the British rule in India. The forces of British India history left a lasting imprint on the now prevailing administrative system. The analysis in the following pages seeks to show how the administrative system that the British evolved while sharing the imperfections inherent in all human institutions brought about inestimable benefits in terms of experiments which eventually helped in our becoming a parliamentary democracy. The East India Company, 1600 to 1772. The history of British rule in India can be traced back to 31st December 1600, when the British Crown granted a group of merchants a monopoly over trade in the eastern waters. The East India Company, as it was called, was a body comprising of merchant adventurers. Its primary objective was the purchase of Indian goods and then selling them in Europe. They arrived on the shores of Bengal strictly as peddlers of their wares, but eventually stayed on to rule. Between 1600 and 1765, the company chiefly remained a trading corporation whose charter was renewed by the Crown from time to time. The year 1765 is an important landmark year for the East India Company, when the Mughal ruler, though was reduced into a titular head with diminished authority and influence, gave the East India Company a charter making it the Diwan of Bengal. In other words, it became the administrator of Bengal. The company had two controlling authorities, the Board of Control and the Court of Directors. The Board of Control was the superior body as it was appointed by the British Parliament, and the Court of Directors consisted of members who were nominated by the proprietors of the company. The most notable contribution of the British, the creation of a body of civil servants, took place during the reign of the company. The civil service under the company was divided into two categories, the covenanted civil service. This service consisted of only Englishmen. It was so called because this category of civil servants entered into a covenant to serve the company faithfully and gave security for doing so. It was divided into different categories such as judicial, political, revenue, and mercantile. The uncovenanted civil service. This service included Indians, Parsis, Englishmen, and the Portuguese. They did not sign any covenant with the company and were therefore called uncovenanted civil servants. This service had no cadre, as candidates to this service were employed to do odd jobs by the company on a temporary basis. They did jobs of a mercantile nature, such as registering, training, or promotion. The possessions of the company were grouped into the three presidencies of Bombay, Calcutta, and Madras. The personnel policies differed from one presidency to the other. Prominent achievements of the company rule, 1773 to 1857. The period of Warren Hastings. The Regulating Act of 1773 can be taken as a starting point, as this can be regarded as the basis of all subsequent legislation for determining the form of Indian government. And this Act of 1773 recognizes the company as fulfilling functions other than those of trade. it applied chiefly to the presidency of Bengal. There was a governor general and council controlling the presidencies of Madras and Bombay, and in all cases relating to war and peace, they were obliged to comply with the order of the governor. Later, in 1833, the governor general of Bengal became the governor general of India, and in 1853, a separate lieutenant governor was appointed for Bengal. It may be recalled that Warren Hastings was appointed governor general under the Act of 1773. Under him, the civil service began to transcend its trading activities. During his regime, the civil service changed from being a brand of commercial adventurers and fortune hunters to a public service in the modern sense of the word. The company, during his regime, from a trader became a government and took up functions of revenue and maintenance of law and order. These were the skeletal functions of a slowly emerging police state. The Secretariat, an important organ of the modern administration, had its beginning in those early days when a nucleus of administration existed. The modern Secretariat had its origin in the office of the factory writers. In Madras and Bengal, there was a secretary to the council of the Governor General, and he was assisted by 5 or 6 junior servants. This structure, created by Hastings, was perfected by his successor, Lord Cornwallis. The period of Lord Cornwallis. The regime of Lord Cornwallis constituted a landmark in the history of the civil service in India. His reforms in regard to public service were memorable. He introduced a highly liberal system of remuneration in lieu of the pittances in the form of pay, until then allowed to all classes, and it offered the recipient no alternative between poverty and dishonesty. He did much to eliminate patronage and saw to it that all important offices were held by the covenanted civil servants. He devised a system of administration that contained within itself correctives against the abuse of power by the officials. The Cornwallis Code, whether for revenue, police, criminal and civil justice or other functions, defined and set bounds to authority, created a procedure by a regular system of appeal, guarded against miscarriage of justice, and founded the civil service of India as it exists to this day. He also separated the customs from the revenue department. Another aspect that deserves mention is that the district officer then enjoyed greater powers than the collector of yesteryears. The reasons attributed are lack of central control due to lack of means of transport and communication, and absence of municipal councils and district boards to limit his authority. During the times of Hastings and Cornwallis, boards were set up for the administration of different departments in Calcutta and Madras. In 1785, there were in Madras board of a trade, a board of revenue, a military board, and a medical board. They were composed of members of the council and other officials and put in charge of the detailed administration of the various departments. In the same year, the Court of Directors declared that the government of the company would be carried on by the Governor General in council through the instrumentality of 4 boards, namely the Board of Council itself, the Military Board, the Board of Trade, and the Board of Revenue. They constituted till the last days of company's rule. However, the weakest point of Lord Cornwallis' regime was his systematic efforts to exclude Indians from taking part in the administration. He did not make any attempts to elevate the conditions of classes retained for subordinate posts by improved pay or prospects of preferment. The period of Wellesley. The period of Wellesley, that is from 1799 to 1805, however, ushered in an epoch in the history of the civil services. The most notable contribution made by him was in the field of training. He was the first to realize that the functions of the company were increasing. Wellesley therefore made quick arrangements for the general cultivation of the company's civil servant. So great was his urgency that without waiting for the approval of the Court of Directors, the period of 1800 to 1854, several departments like the Persian Department, the Clothing Board, and Board of Customs were created, merged with others, or abolished. The name of the Board of Revenue at Calcutta was changed to Southern Board of Revenue in 1829, and another such board was set up at Allahabad in 1833. The Charter Act of 1833, together with renewing the company's charter for a period of 20 years, made several other provisions. The unwieldy presidency of Bengal was divided into two parts, those of Bengal and Agra. The Governor General of Bengal became the Governor General of India. All civil and military powers came to be vested in him. Also, the activities of the company as a commercial body came to an end. The next act in line was Charter Act of 1853. This abolished the system of patronage and introduced the system of open competition as a method of recruitment. The entrance examination was to be conducted in London by a civil service commission, which was set up in 1854. The appointment of the Macaulay Committee marked the beginning of an experiment made on the Indian soil for the first time. From here began the chain of administrative reforms, for which purpose the British government set up various commissions, committees, boards, study teams, etc. From this time onwards, it became customary of the British government to appoint committees for special areas of administration. Reports in their findings were also published. They were called commissions because they were appointed by the British monarch under his seal. The Macaulay Committee report of 1854 is considered the Bible on competitive recruitment and training. Essentially, the Indian Revolution of 1857 created the setting for the Act. It is noteworthy that the Act abolished the Court of Directors and the Board of Control. It transferred the government, territories, and revenues of India from the company to the Crown. It also authorized the appointment of an additional Principal Secretary of State for India and created the Council of India. Apart from these, the Act did not make any drastic changes in the system of government. The Governor General continued to be all-powerful. Conditions of service of the public services were now to be determined by the Secretary of State. The decadence of the indigenous institution of self-government, the village panchayat, grouping of provinces without regard to wholesome principles such as racial, cultural, or linguistic affinities, enormous growth in public taxation and expenditure, particularly the growth of military expenditure, insufficient attention given to nation building activities such as education, public health, irrigation and cooperation, neglect of indigenous industry and agriculture resulting in extreme poverty, excessive curbs on the political activities of the people by imposing restrictions upon the freedom of the press, speech and movement. The bureaucracy was highly centralized, and the Act of 1858 did show a degree of awareness in remedying it. But this process was too slow. In 1859, Canning introduced the portfolio system. Under this, the work of the government, divided into several branches, was entrusted to different members of the Governor General's Council, the Act of 1861. The Act of 1861 did initiate the process of decentralization. The Act restored and the legislative councils of Bombay, Madras, and some of their lost powers, and provided for the setting up of new council in other provinces as well. However, most of the legislation enacted by these provincial legislatures had to receive the consent of the Governor General. Provision was also made for the inclusion of some Indians in the Council of the Governor General, the Indian Act of 1892. The Indian Act of 1892 enlarged the functions of the legislative councils. Though the system of direct elections was not approved, the preliminary process took place. Prior to nomination, the government was obliged to consult certain bodies such as municipalities, landholders, etc. The government could, however, reject their recommendations. Morley Minto Reforms, 1909. The Indian Council Act, the Morley Minto Reforms of 1909, was an extension of the Act of 1892. It further increased the size of the legislative councils. The provincial councils could have a majority of non-officials. The Decentralization Commission, appointed in the same year, also made recommendations for the revival and growth of panchayats and lessening of government control over local bodies. Next was the Government of India Act 1919. It was based on the premises that popular control in the field of local government should be established, the provincial governments be made responsible to the popular representatives, and the control of British Parliament and the Secretary of State be relaxed. An important aspect of this act was that local self-government became a provisional and transferred subject under a responsible Indian minister. In 1923, the British government appointed the Royal Commission on the Superior Civil Services in India under the chairmanship of Lord Lee of Farham. The most notable contribution of this commission was that it recommended the establishment of a public service commission. A decision to implement this recommendation was taken in 1926. The Federal Public Service Commission, consisting of a chairman and four other members, was appointed, and it started functioning with effect from 1926. It was entrusted mainly with the recruitment function, though it could be consulted by the government on disciplinary matters also. However, its role in the pre-independence era was purely advisory. The experiment with provincial autonomy was as dismal as the two mentioned earlier. It was enforced in 1937 and gave up in 1939 because the Congress ministers in the provinces resigned in protest against the British decision to push India into the Second World War. The Governor General had overriding powers over the administration of a province. In the meantime, three new departments, namely Information and Broadcasting, Civil Defense, and Indians Overseas, were created in 1941. The Indians Overseas Department was redesigned as the Department of Commonwealth in April 1944. In June 1947, it was merged into the Department of External Affairs and Commonwealth Relations. In 1942, the Department of Food was created, and in 1943, the Department of Civil Supplies was merged into the Industries and Civil Supplies Department. In 1944, the Department of Planning was established but was abolished in July 1946. After the end of Second World War in 1945, the Department of Education, Health and Lands was split into three separate departments, that is Education, Health and Agriculture. After independence, all departments were redesigned as ministries on 29th August 1947. Friends, in this lesson, we have dealt with the East India Company 1600 to 1772, the Covenanted Civil Services, the Uncovenanted Civil Services, and prominent achievements of the company rule, and others.